Hey Potters, I'm back!
Yay, she's back and I don't have to do this all alone! Yay!
Happy to be alive! I promise, I have not abandoned you guys. We're not pod fading, nothing like that. I should say this is episode 77 of Cospod, the podcast for all things cosplay. Of course, I am the previously missing Amber, one of the co-hosts of this show, if you guys haven't noticed. I bought a new house.
Yay!
And needless to say, moving in has been more of a chore than I thought it would be, given that I have had the infestation of fleas from hell. They literally will not die, no matter what has been done to them. So I have basically been stuck dealing between that and having to work on call. In fact, I'm on call again this weekend. So if you see me suddenly dart off screen, it's not because I don't like you guys. It's not because Charlie smells. It's not because anything like that's going on. It's because I suddenly got a call from work that I have to go answer. So, but anyways, on to the more cosplay-related side of things. We have a packed show for you guys today. Oh my gosh, there has been so much stuff going on recently. We'll be diving into Anime North Texas, the aftermath of that. There's been a new mini-documentary from PBS that has been running around on YouTube. And we're also going to talk about the controversial article that was recently done by, I believe it was Complex, regarding the golden age of cosplay and whether or not we are actually past that point. So let's go ahead and start off, as we normally do, with cosplay progress. Val?
Wait, before we start that off, who's the person sitting next to you, Amber? Let's introduce them, why don't we? Jeez.
I'm not important.
Yeah, you are.
It was difficult enough to persuade her to be on the show. Hi.
Hi, I'm Charlie. I'm known as Charlemagne in local cosplay circles. I've been cosplaying for 12 years. I'm just hanging out.
Yes, she's going to be one of my roommates in the house, which is why she is here. She is graciously helping me to get things cleaned up and hopefully make this more like, you know, a livable house instead of shack o' fleas. So this weekend is for getting things done at the Amber household.
Mm-hmm. But she's also a really good cosplayer. She does a lot of really cool wigs, and I've sent people to her for wig commissions.
Oh, just wig commissions, incidentally.
Yes.
I'm the reason for some of your business. Enjoy.
Hey, Charlemagne Cosplay on Facebook. There's my plug.
All right, now we can move on to cosplay. Okay. Jeez, Amber, so just not considerate of you.
I just got off an hour-long work call, man. My brain is in that room.
That's fine.
I'm not offended.
So, updates. My updates are kind of limited. I know Amber's been busy movie, so she probably doesn't have a whole lot to share.
My stuff's in the boxes, man.
Yeah, I was about to say, most of my stuff, I've got pictures on our Facebook page of the wig that I've been working on, which is probably going to get destroyed and remade because I know myself and I don't like the front of it. Mostly, I've just been working on armor templates because Val's going to be making armor templates. A lot of it's crotch armor templates. Awesome stuff.
For what?
Rosa the Crimson from Final Fantasy VII, Dirge of Cerberus.
Cool.
She has lots of very inappropriate armor, not very practical armor.
Armor.
Like, her art pieces make total sense. They're legit armor. The rest of it is just very fancy, and it's just there for decoration, not for practical use. Yeah. Other than that, it has been doing lots of dyeing of this lovely, lovely stretch crystal ribbon, which is why my fingers are still kind of blue. Actually, if we look really, really closely, you can kind of see the blue still on them. Yeah, buddy.
You've all been there.
Oh, yeah. I pretty much have resigned myself to being blue hands at least once a week, because I die with so much blue these days. But yeah, that's pretty much it. Other than that, I have been oogling and giggling over my costume porn. Look at this!
Costume porn.
It is such costume porn. Oh my goodness. I couldn't stop dying this last
night. This book.
It's actually on sale right now at Amazon, which is the reason why I got this, because otherwise it retails for $60.
Oh, yeah, less than I was thinking.
If anybody is looking for gifts to get your favorite Star Wars fan, order now.
Exactly, right? But it's just been like, oh, this is such glorious costume porn. I mean, look, costume porn. Ah! Okay, I won't do any more than that, otherwise I might get in trouble.
You can't show that on family-friendly television.
That looked like it was pretty family-friendly. It's Star Wars.
I was making a porn joke.
It was bad, bad. So yeah, that's my...
For 3 years, it's not getting any better.
No, it's not. It's okay. But yeah, that's been my costuming. It hasn't been very busy. Most of it's just been prepping for A&T, trying to get things rolling for that, getting all that stuff uploaded as we have been. And if you're watching our Facebook page today, you'll notice that we've got another one panel up, the electronics panel. So give it a look, please.
Yep, and more will come as I'm able to process them. I have to move them from my laptop to my desktop for processing. So a lot of our equipment is just aging. Although I will say that I've pretty much decided on what panels I'm teaching for ACON. Speaking of cosplay prep, I'm going to try and team teach an armoring panel on attachments and painting, basically the finishing of armor. I'm going to teach one about all the different things you can do to fabric for effects. So, you know, dyeing, distressing, felting, all that good stuff. Mm-hmm. I will not light it on fire.
Run over it with your car?
No, I will not run over it with my car.
That was my favorite thing to do. I love distressing.
Yes, but I will be team teaching a panel on all the different things you can do to fabric. I am going to pick up the book, The Art of Manipulating Fabric, as well, because they have some pretty nifty ideas in there, too, for things you can do to fabric for effect. Mm-hmm. And then I'm going to teach a Kinzashi panel, if they'll let me do it. Now, all of these are if they will let me do it, because they haven't actually started taking panel submissions officially yet. So it's just a matter of, okay, I have to write them up, and then start getting people and supplies together to see what I can do.
Right.
Yeah, that's been the extent of my cosplay life. It's like, oh God, we have to start working on ACON stuff already. It's November! Yes, we know.
We're fully aware of that. That's why I kept pinging them like, hey guys, why aren't the panel submissions up yet? Usually you guys would say no more by now. OCD person in me is not liking this.
Well, speaking of prepping for conventions, we actually were at A&T this last weekend. Yay!
That's Anime North Texas. Let's parse that out.
Yes. Yes, Anime North Texas, which was held in Fort Worth. I believe this is their second year. At the Radisson Hotel. And so let's get right back into it. They grew.
Yeah, they grew. If you just took like one look at the photos that I've posted on our Flickr page, it's like, last year, 120 photos. This year, 1,000 photos. Okay, cool.
From what I saw, a lot of people brought their A-game, and I think we talked about that at on-site, how
people
brought a lot of really epic stuff.
It was crazy to see just that many people with so many awesome costumes. I was like, oh, man. If all these people entered into the contest, we're never going to get out.
Yeah, there was a large expansion, both of attendees in general and of the cosplaying population. There were probably a good 50-60% of the people who were there were in costume. The vast majority of people we saw were cosplayers, which made our little podcaster hearts feel good.
Kept us busy, that's for sure.
Oh, definitely. The guests this year were Heidi O'Farrell and Sparkle Pipsy, and Vorpal Props, all of whom are very awesome people to meet in person. And, of course, they all ran panels during the weekend, and so we managed to film what we could of those. And we also interviewed Sparkle Pipsy. She was gracious enough to sit down with us for 10 minutes in between panels.
I'm spazzing out because she was so cool. Oh, my goodness. Amber's going to be mad at me because I, like, hijack the interview, and it's like 80% about Sailor Moon and cosplay construction revolving around the Scouts, and the rest of it is kind of about cosplay of other stuff.
This is relevant to my interests.
So, for y'all's viewing pleasure, we present to you the interview with Sparkle Pipsy.
Hey, everybody, all the potters out there. guess who I have with me? It's Sparkle Pipsy!
Thank you so much for interviewing with us, because you're one of my favorites. I look up to you. You're so cool and inspirational. Tell us a little bit about yourself, why you got into cosplay, all that business.
Okay, first off, you're so sweet.
Aww,
and
thank you
for having me. I'm Sparkle Pipsy. My real name's Suzanne. You can call me either, I respond to both. But I've been cosplaying for 14 years. I've been making my costumes for 10 years. So I usually say 10 plus, so I don't sound too old, but I just gave it away. Oh well. But I live in Southern California. I mostly frequent those conventions. I love performing at masquerades. I love dressing up as sparkly idols and magical girls. And I like making my costumes light up. And that's about it.
So what was your very first costume?
My first costume ever was Sailor Venus. I'm a huge, huge, huge Sailor Moon fan. Like, no matter what happens, no matter what amazing anime comes out, Sailor Moon will always, always be my favorite by default. Like, it'll always be there.
That's actually a good way to start into the next question. I know a lot of people who are Sailor Moon cosplayers, we look to your guide and your tutorials on how to make our costumes. So what made you want to make those?
Well, okay, so back at, I think it was Fanime 2011, a group of friends and me, we did an intercenti group, and I had already made like 6 or 7 Sailor Fuku. There's so many ways to make them, and there's so many difficult things about them. So I had already done like a ton of trial and error. So when I got hooked up with this group, I was like, oh my gosh, okay, I have a bunch of tips that I think we can use for this group, because I've learned all the wrong ways to do it. I think this will work for us. And so I put together basically what you would find on DeviantArt now. I put together a little guide for them, like, oh, this is how big you make your skirt, this is how you do this and this. And then after we did our group, a lot of people were like, wow, your costumes are so nice, and how did you do it? And I was like, oh, I have this handy guide already. I should just polish it up. So I did polish it up quite a bit just to make it so that it was a little bit more cohesive. And then I put it up on DeviantArt, and yeah, it's gotten a lot of attention, and I'm really happy that it helps a lot of cosplayers. And it's funny because that style of skirt, I feel like, is kind of unique to that look. So sometimes I'll see a girl across the con floor, and I'm like, I wonder if they used my tutorial. And then they'll come up to me and be like, I used your tutorial! And I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't so called it. But
so what do you think is the most difficult part of making the Sailor Scout outfit?
I think, honestly, probably the skirts, just because you have like this, like this, you know,
yeah,
this like
V-shaped
shape
thing
here,
in front.
And then you need to attach a pleated skirt to it somehow. And I know when I was figuring it out for the first time, that was the part that just, how do you do that? And so, and even since making my tutorial, I feel like I need to go back and like refresh it, because I've made like I think 4 more Sailor Fukus since I made that, so it's like I keep learning new stuff. And yeah, that part is definitely the trickiest, I think.
Now, I noticed with your tutorial, you don't use the satin that a lot of people tend to gravitate towards. Why did you pick that particular material?
I really like poplin, because it comes in every color under the rainbow, so if you're trying to get a group that looks cohesive, it's really easy to be like, okay, let's all use poplin, we'll all be able to find the fabric that we want. And also, like, it doesn't wrinkle, which is amazing. It pleats super easy, and you kind of avoid the problem of sometimes it's satin, like if not like every seam is perfect, there'll be like puckers, and you'll see like a weird wrinkle or whatever.
Right.
With poplin, it's not quite as noticeable, so there's a little bit of room for error there, which is kind of nice. And actually, like, I do recommend poplin, although if you like satin skirts, I'd say go for it. I've done a couple satin skirts since making that tutorial, but yeah, just know it has a little bit more room for error.
Is there more forgiveness?
Yeah. Poplin is a little more forgiving, for sure.
Okay, so we're going to get out of Sailor Moon mode, because I can probably talk about it for the next hour and a half.
Yeah, me too.
What has been your favorite costume to wear so far? I know, it's like picking your favorite child or your favorite pet. Good luck.
Favorite pet. I can do that. My favorite costume to wear probably is I made an idol version of Minako Aino, or her Sailor Venus.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's so stupid looking. Like, the design is so dumb. Like, it's like lime green and orange and yellow and like totally clashy 90s, like classic Sailor Moon, terrible, like 90s nice. Badness with like a tutu that's like a lampshade, and it's so ridiculous, but I love it. It's just so fun to wear.
So obviously I'm sensing Sailor Venus is kind of a theme.
Yes.
Have you done any of the other Sailor Scouts?
I have. I've done usually for a group where it's like I've done Jupiter a couple times because I'm a little taller.
Right.
I do love her though. She's pretty awesome. And I've done Moon. I've also done Moon a couple times.
Okay.
That time was for like masquerade skits. So it was like our group was in need of a Moon. I was like, all right.
So what's your favorite thing about performing for a stage contest?
I was a big theater geek in high school, and pretty much all growing up, actually. Even when I was really young, I was into theater. And that masquerade to me is kind of like taking my cosplay hobby that I love, and like it's reminiscent of the theater, of that sort of aspect of my life. And so it's I enjoy theater and I enjoy performing, so.
Awesome. So now we get to give to my favorite questions. What's your favorite material to work with?
Favorite material to work with? Well, I've already mentioned poplin. I do use poplin a lot for stuff. Oh my gosh, you're gonna have to cut this because I'm gonna have to think for a second. I don't like working with any material. Just kidding.
We've had that answer before, so you wouldn't be the first.
No, I
hate all of it.
It's like, actually, it's kind of funny because I don't really like sewing that
really
much. Like, sewing is probably like my least favorite part of cosplay, where it's like I really love the planning process. I really love the brainstorming, like, oh, how am I gonna do this, but the hours sitting behind my sewing machine, I'm just like, if I could skip that part, that would be, I'd be fine with that, and then just skip to the, oh, I have an awesome costume exactly how I want it, yay.
Right.
But I do like one material that comes to mind. It's not, I can't say that it's like my favorite ever, but that I use a lot, especially with boot covers, is like this four-way stretch vinyl that I have it, that I'm able to find in the LA Fashion District. And it's like, I love that stuff. It's just,
it comes in handy.
It comes in handy. Like, whenever I go shopping, like, I'll just get a whole bunch of it, and I end up using it for a lot of stuff. Like boot covers, obviously, it's nice because it has like that shoe like texture, so
exactly.
It doesn't just look like, oh, a cloth boot cover, whatever. It looks pretty legit, but also just for trims and stuff, like, it can add a little texture, a little variety to a costume. So I like that stuff.
Okay, so then your least favorite, I guess, would be sewing.
Least favorite is any like super shiny satin that like disintegrates when
costume
you look
satin.
At it. Yeah, even some bridal satins. Oh my gosh, just recently last week, I made Cure Rhythm from Sweet Pretty Cure with my friend Marissa for a masquerade competition, and we got what we thought was nice satin. We're like, this stuff's super nice. And then as soon as I started sewing with it, it's just like, it's fraying all over the place. Like, the seams are like coming apart. Like, even the, like, there's nothing wrong with my seam. There's nothing wrong.
Yeah.
There's something wrong with this fabric. It's just falling apart. But yeah, that's the worst.
Oh, goodness. Okay, and then the final question is, do you have any tips or advice for new cosplayers?
I would say the internet is your friend. Like, honestly, don't look, like, always start, you can start with something crazy if you want. Just know that it, like, you will come across a lot of bump, like a bumpy road or whatever. But don't ever look at something that someone made and be like, oh my gosh, they're so amazing. Like, I could never do that. You can do it. And the internet can help you. And, cause seriously, like, I feel like, when I started cosplaying 14 years ago, there wasn't as many resources on the internet, but now you can find a tutorial for anything. Like, it's just, like, if you're like, oh my gosh, I want to make some, like, crazy armor, I want to make, you know, whatever, you look it up, you can find, you can figure it out, and you can do it. With determination, you can do it.
The power of Google.
Yes.
Well, thank you so much. Everyone, sparkle pips. Yay!
Thank you.
And we're back. But as far as A&T itself goes, they're going to need a new hotel next year, just because they've pretty much taken up all the space that they can take in that hotel and still be able to move around.
Yeah, I hope they don't have like a 5-6 year contract with them. I'm hoping that they're able to, you know, yeah, I hope it was just like a 1 year term and just kind of add to it. Because there's no way they can hold it there.
They were there last year, I believe, too. Because, yeah, and I would worry about, if it getting too big, I'd worry about a fire marshal coming in and clearing it out, you know.
Exactly.
So they'll need to move next year, if possible. And that will bring a whole new slew of, you know, organizational issues, as cons do when they get bigger and they move. But one of the things that I was really surprised about, from what I heard from, you know, other attendees, because, you know, Val was there Saturday. I was also there Saturday. I went Sunday, but neither of us went Friday. Mm-hmm. And from what I heard from attendees, Friday was very slow. And from what I saw on Sunday, Sunday was very slow. Saturday was just jam-packed. So I feel like A&T could benefit if they were able to spread their programming out just a little bit more so that they wouldn't effectively be a one-day con. Mm-hmm. They'll be a full three-day con to where people want to buy weekend passes and not just one-day passes, because we do want to support our local cons. So I think, you know, one of the criticisms that I heard, that I don't know personally if this is how it went down, is that a lot of their cosplay programming was pretty much in a single block on Friday. You know, it was all during a certain time period of the day where very few people could attend. Mm-hmm. So, well, if cosplay happens to be a main part of your con and a main, you know, fandom that supports your convention, you may wish to consider moving that around so that more of the fandom can attend, because then they'll also be there to patronize the dealer's den, go in the artist alley, participate in the cosplay contest. They'll be there to be more of a con goer. Instead of just kind of ghosting the con, which, you know, not getting down on people ghosting cons, we just want to help support the cons financially because that's how they stick around. Mm-hmm. So I think moving programming around just a bit as far as cosplay goes may benefit them.
And say, on that same train of thought, I think also because of the time of year that it's held, it's a little bit tricky because most of us, of the people, at least those who are the general population who go to conventions that are anime-oriented, are going to be teenagers still in high school. They're going to be young college students who are still in school. Friday's a little tricky to get off. Honestly, I think A&T is one of those conventions that would really benefit by having it be just a two-day, Saturday, Sunday only. Take that Friday programming, move it to Sunday. Maybe that will help encourage people to show up on Sunday instead. So it's just something to throw out there. I don't know if they'll actually do it, but yeah, the timing of the year is not quite ideal for those of us who have real lives to deal with.
Mm-hmm. I would like to give kudos to the staff at A&T. I did not have any problems with any of the staff personally. They were very gracious and quick in helping pick up our press passes. Mm-hmm. You know, they gave us all the information we needed. They even gave us lanyards. And we pretty much had the ability to do what we needed to do. The only time I ever really had, you know, a run-in with staff was when I was sitting in a hallway for a moment waiting for a panel to start. And they told me I wasn't allowed to sit in the hallways due to fire rules, to fire marshal rules. Which surprised me a little, because I know that San Japan has really been strict about those, about not letting people sit in the halls. And I understand why they do that. At the same time, there is not adequate seating in that hotel for the number of people that were there. There's not enough places for us to just sit if we need to sit. So I think that that would help if they could get even just temporary seating so that people aren't congregating in the hallways like that.
Mm-hmm.
But other than that, I found the staff to be, you know, very, very helpful. And if they didn't know the answer to something, they would reach out and find the person that did. So, you know, bravo to the staff.
Say, on that note, since you're talking about the staff, let's talk about the cosplay staff and how absolutely awesome and amazing they are for being, like, the bestest human beings in the universe, like, ever. No, seriously, I think the reason I say that is because, and I mentioned this to Kat, who is head of the cosplay staff, is that last year I was really disappointed that we couldn't post a lot of photos online of the cosplay contest because, unfortunately, a lot of people just weren't stopping to get their photos taken. And it was very unfortunate, and something that Amber and I both really strive for whenever it comes to anything with cosplay is we like to post every single picture we take. I mean, short of it being fuzzy or impossible to see the person, we want to give everybody the credit that they're due. Yeah, that. So I was really, really, really happy when Kat took a moment and told everybody in the cosplay contest, okay, this is the reason why you need to stop for poses. And they went through an entire, you know, presentation about how to pose, how to stop, how to do their thing in front of all the contestants, and they had all the cosplay staff come up and help. And it was just like, thank you so much a million times over, because we could post every freaking photo this time. And that's never happened before. So, like, I bow down to them. Thank you so much for that. You guys have no idea how happy that made me.
This was before the cosplay contest, by the way. For those who are like, I don't remember seeing this. They actually did it before the general audience was let in. This was when, you know, basically press and staff were in the room along with the contestants. And they had, you know, the other cosplay staffers act as a cosplay group to actually go up and model what they were wanting contestants to do, because for those who have never been in a cosplay contest, it can be really intimidating to walk the stage the first time. You feel like 30 seconds is forever, you feel all these eyes on you, you feel like they're mm-hmm. judging you, and you just want to run across the stage and have done. But if you went through all the work to make that costume and then, you know, entered the contest, if you're going to go through it, get some good pictures. And to do that, you know, we need a little help from the cosplayers.
We want you to show it off. Yeah. The whole point, right?
Yeah. We just want them to slow down just a little bit. We know you're nervous. We have been there ourselves. We're all experienced cosplay contestants.
I still go through it, too. Being in theater... Just kidding. Being in theater has taught me how long 30 seconds really is. When you're singing a song, it's really not that long, but when you are presenting yourself on stage, it is a long time, because that's, you know, you think it's so fast because 30 seconds seems like such a minuscule amount, so you just go through it fast, but you get across that stage and it's only been 6 seconds. Mm-hmm. You have all this time left. And so it's really just learning the value of that time in, you know, without the adrenaline, you know, in your system.
Exactly. I think once you experience it and you realize, oh, 30 seconds, that's like a lifetime. It's not until you get that experience you realize just how valuable that time really is.
Yeah, but they did a really, really good job of basically modeling what they wanted, giving good instructions. I will say that not all of the contestants did it. There were still a couple of people that literally walked across the stage and maybe stopped once.
Sure.
And I did feel kind of bad for them, because it's like, we want to take your picture, you know, we want you to enjoy yourself on stage. But the vast majority of them really took that advice to heart. And, you know, kudos to Kat-Chan, not only for doing that, but for running such a tight ship.
Mm-hmm.
That costume cosplay contest It was over in an hour and a half.
Nice.
I mean, they were in and out.
And there was a lot of contestants, too.
I want to say there were 36, I think. Something close to that.
I'm going to start counting while you keep talking. Hang on. Flicker away!
Basically, they let the general audience in about 15 minutes prior to start, and they weren't sitting in there very long before they went ahead and they started. And everything just ran very, very consistently. They had their little halftime show where they showed cosplay videos while the judges were deliberating, and then they came up and they did the awards just boom, boom, boom. Everything was very efficient. I mean, there were no, you know, just random twiddling of thumbs sitting around going, okay, what do we do now? It was very tightly run in a good way.
We like contests like that because we're so used to like wasting 4 or 5 hours with them and all the prep work that goes with it. So it's nice when it's so well ran that you're just like, okay, cool. What do I do with the rest of the day, Mike?
And they did prejudging this year, which I don't think they did last year.
They did last year, but they're very quick about it.
Okay. Because I know they had set aside a block of time this year that was actually on the schedule that was for prejudging, and that was good.
I'm slowly counting.
As far as the layout of the hotel goes, I was very glad that in the main area of the hotel, they do have a lot of seating out there in the lobby area where people can just kind of sit and congregate. Because one of the best things that I enjoy about A&T is the atmosphere of the con. It's a very social con. They encourage you to sit down, chat with people, just kind of take a load off. It's not a very driven con. And, you know, for those of us that go to a lot of driven cons, it's nice to have a little bit of a break every so often and go to one of those laid back, just kind of, hey man, how's it going kind of cons.
Right.
So kudos to them for having that kind of a setup there in the Radisson to where everything is just laid out so that you can meander through the artist alley, you know, go around the dealer's den area. And, you know, if you want to sit back, relax, and people watch, you can. So I really like the feel that they were able to get across with that hotel and with, you know, that many people. It's kind of hard to do laid back when you have that many people around.
I counted 47. I may be a number or two off because I was smart. Val was smart this time. She decided that just in case if people were speeding across the stage, I ran back behind the scenes and I took photos of every single cosplayer as they were standing in line, except at the end where everybody was clustered into panel room 3, so I had to make a good estimation of who was sitting there. But it worked and it looks really cool. So I'm saying 47 contestants. There we go.
So 47 is quite a chunk to get through in an hour and a half, mm-hmm. including halftime. So, you know.
They're efficient.
Yeah. Yes, and I'm sure it will continue to improve. I know that they had one skit this past year.
Mm-hmm.
I'm hoping that they have a few more next year because I would like to see some more skits if
Absolutely.
Possible. Mm-hmm. Other than that, any other thoughts? Val, any other thoughts about A&T?
Any other thoughts? You know what? I still like the fact that it is more of a relaxing con. I know Saturday we were kind of, you know, unhappy at the fact that there was a big chunk of time where there was no cosplay panels, like right in the middle. But I get it. They mostly reserve those for the judges. And that was prejudging time, so that makes sense. It's fine. But it was good to have another relaxing con. I know that's something that Amber and I really miss this year because we're always busy, 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 on the go. And especially since we don't go to A-Fest anymore, which used to be our relaxing con, this is the nice break that we need before convention season starts ramping up again in the spring. I like how you both are nodding at the same time. I'm glad we agree.
Yes.
No issues with A-Fest at all.
Oh, well, I went to A-Fest. I had fun.
Oh, yeah. Hey.
As hard as we are on A-Fest, It's not because we're trying to be dicks.
This is family friendly.
I'll rate it unclean if that's what they want for that.
But yeah, you're fine.
I mean, we're not trying to be
jerk butts. How about that?
Yeah. We're saying this because, as you know, former A-Fest attendees who really liked the con, we want it to improve, and we want it to have that laid-back atmosphere that it had without completely losing coherence as a con. You know, it still needs to be run efficiently as a con. It still needs to have decent programming. It still needs to have, you know, a cosplay experience that encourages people to take part, and then still preserve that kind of relaxed feeling as a con. That's what we want out of A-Fest, and we feel like it's not happening, and no matter what suggestions we seem to give, that they're either not feasible or just not followed or, you know, what have you. Basically, it's not moving in the direction that, as fans, we would like it to move in, and that's why we're so hard on it. Mm-hmm. So that's the long and short of that.
Anyway, more happy note.
So
I pick on it. I really don't. It just hurts me as a panelist because I've presented there for 3 years running, and I always had a blast. And then the last couple of years have just broken my heart, and that's why I keep pushing it to improve. And it's like, nope, not happening. So ACON gets all my A+ material.
Yes, which hopefully we will both be teaching at ACON this year. And I am aiming to be on staff next year also to help out even more with the con. As well as all con contests. You know, I'm thinking about teaching at all con too, so we'll see how that goes. I'm going to end up being even more of a panelist this year than I normally do.
Amber's always a teacher.
Speaking of teaching, great segue.
Segue!
We're going to do the Golden Age one first.
Okay.
And this is the reason that teaching is the segue, is that there was an article recently, I believe it was under Complex is the name of the group, correct me if I'm wrong.
I'm Googling now.
That did an article featuring Yaya Han.
Hey, you're right, it's Complex.
About whether the golden age of cosplay has peaked, because Yaya seems to think it has. Now, without going into, you know, the whole drama-filled underbelly of cosplay, whatever you think of Yaya Han, we're not going to go there. Instead, we wanted to take a little more philosophical approach and talk about, well, what exactly is the golden age of cosplay? Have we reached it yet? And one of the things that she had mentioned in the article was that conventions are now bringing on cosplayers more as celebrities than teachers. Implying that, you know, back in the day they would bring on cosplayers as teachers in this golden age. Hi, have we met? We're cosplay. We spend our entire times teaching panels at cons, if we're not filming, teaching things.
Yeah. Most we don't get breaks.
Also teach panels at cons. Now,
yeah, exactly. Point.
Yeah, it's like, hi, have we met? We're teachers. Now, granted, we may not be invited nearly as often to cons as guests.
I've never been invited as a guest.
For that. And that does kind of bother me a little bit, that those who are being invited as the cosplay guests of honor are pretty much those who have extensive cosplay repertoire that is complicated. Mm-hmm. You know, the people who make the very ornate costumes, or those who basically work as models. They work as cosplay models. It's like, mm-hmm. It would be really nice if conventions could take the panoramic view of cosplay, that there is more to cosplay than just making an ornate costume and wearing it. How did you get there? How did you make that costume? You know, are you somebody that can help provide content to a con, kind of like ANT, where the guests all taught very substantial panels? So they also came as teachers. I like it. We need more of that.
I think it also depends on the type of convention that it is, because I'll notice that with anime conventions, you're more likely to get the cosplay guests who are both there as guests as well as teachers, versus the comic books, the gaming conventions, where it's not so much about teaching panels on cosplay, it's really about you showing up as a model and having your thing there. You get your own booth, you sell your own merchandise, that's your shindig. So I think it's about the type of convention, too.
Yeah, the culture of the individual conventions.
Absolutely. That was way more eloquent than how I put it.
And I don't necessarily think that this was something that was done more in the past than it is now, you know, in Planet Golden Age. For as long as I've been going to conventions, as long as I can remember, the cosplay guests have been sort of celebrity figures. I can't think of a single time when a cosplay guest, outside of literally ANT and GlitchCon where we were guests, that a cosplayer that is known for their teaching has been invited to a con.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't necessarily think that's indicating that, you know, there's this golden age that's falling out. I think we haven't even reached that point yet.
And, well, I mean, what defines the golden age of something? Anyway, what defined the golden age of Hollywood? What defines the golden age of comics? I mean, really, what defines that is the future looking back. And so who's to say that we're out of it or in it or it hasn't happened yet, you know?
Exactly.
Well, I will say, and this is the only thing that I'm going to say, you know, about Yaya in particular regarding the article, and this is because this is why the article was supposedly given credence, is the author of that article basically said that since Yaya has been in this industry, cosplay, for so long, and because she is considered a cosplay ambassador, regardless of where that came from, because she is seen as such, she ought to know what the golden age of cosplay is. I would say usually it's not up to one person to define the entire realm of cosplay for us as a community. I think it's for us as a community to define where we're going,
mm-hmm.
you know, as a community. It's not, there's no king and queen of cosplay.
And I mean, and she is perfectly entitled to her opinion, and that doesn't make her opinion wrong, it's an opinion, and that's okay, you know, and it's okay for someone to disagree. So, you know, that's where we get intellectual discourse. if we can do that, that's where we get intellectual discourse within our community about the hobby that we all enjoy.
So. She's using big words today, Amber. I don't know if I like this.
I lost my mic again.
I mean, generally, you know, the golden age of anything, if you look at history, just in general, is where we have the greatest contribution to society, basically where that thing has done the most good. Right. It has educated people, it has improved their lives, it has, you know, increased participation in society, it's made us better people. I think widely we could agree that that is a loose definition of a golden age.
Sure.
So then as a cosplay community, we would have to decide what is the best way for us to help people. What can we do to enrich society? How does cosplay make us a better being? Have we gotten there yet? No. I think we're still trying to decide who the heck we are as a community, frankly. We don't even know who we are as a community. I mean, we're still stuck in the freaks and geeks kind of mentality in society.
And there's so many schisms, you know, different cliques within our community as a whole, and that's a shame, really. Because, we can't go talk to them over there, they're blah, you know, for example. There's, mm-hmm. there's your non-big word there, Val. They're blah.
Yay! Now it's a podcast.
Yeah.
And to me, it's interesting how you brought up the golden age of Hollywood, because most people will say, you know, this time period is the golden age. But when you talk to film theorists, we're like, no, that's totally not the golden age, because we use Amber's definition where it's the time period where we learned the most, where we contributed the most to the medium. And all that happened from, like, 1909 to 1915. Like, that's the golden age for film theorists, because that's when everything was introduced and all the concepts. But everybody's like, no. The golden age of Hollywood is way later.
I think it's the studio era. But it's
exactly. They think of that.
The studio era.
Exactly. And everybody, for film theorists, that's always our biggest contention. And I've written so many freaking papers about this, too. And for me, it's like, I don't think cosplay has yet to reach a pinnacle. I think the day that I can watch BlizzCon and not be amazed by the costumes, I think that'll be the pinnacle. But every freaking year, I look at BlizzCon photos, and I keep getting amazed. And I keep getting more amazed. And it keeps getting better and better. And I was just like, oh, man. When we reach that point, then yes, the golden age is over, because we can't make any more awesome Blizzard costumes. There's my standard.
Yeah, I guess that would basically be it. The pinnacle would be when nothing else better can be made. And because exactly. It's a creative hobby. Just like film, you'll always be able to make improvements. Things will always change. You'll always be able to learn something new. Film reached the golden age, reached its pinnacle, and then it was in a slump for a long time.
You know, absolutely.
And then films like Star Wars came out and revolutionized things, and now we're learning more about how to make films, CGI, things like that have come. So once we get to the point where nothing better can be made is when we will start to decline.
And you'll notice that we're learning a lot of new techniques now. People are starting to learn how to use new materials, new techniques. The YouTube is just a wealth of information about tutorials that there didn't used to be. I mean, there are new things. I mean, even Warbler is considered old now in terms of thermoplastics because they're just coming up with so many new synthetics that people can work with in terms of cosplay. They're even coming up with synthetic fabrics, like fiber optic fabric.
Yeah.
So you put lights in them and the entire fabric glows.
I have some and I've been playing with it. It's so cool.
I've even seen people like, I know this isn't like new, but I've seen people start to synthesize. I went to school for theater. I've seen people start to synthesize old makeup and wig working techniques from the theater that they've been using in the theatrical industry for decades, and longer. They've started to implement that into cosplay, which is adding even more, you know, fuel to that fire. I mean, people are discovering makeups and makeup techniques that they've used for a long, long time to better their abilities. So it's kind of interesting to see how they've synthesized the old with the new.
Definitely. I'm going to throw in a quote that Allie, hi Allie, that Allie typed for us in the QA. One is that art is ever evolving. Yes, it absolutely is. But then another thing that she said about Yaya was that her position in the community is so much different from where we all stand that her point of view may not be as overarching as the way that we view everything. We probably see everything on the outside because, I mean, that's basically what we do. That's podcasters, but for her, she has such a niche and narrow market point that she probably doesn't see the entire perspective of cosplay.
Plus, we try and take from multiple perspectives anyway.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we try and look at things as a whole, as a podcast, even though, you know, we have our own niches, cosplayers, but we try and look at it in a more broad sense so that we're more inclusive as a community.
And Yaya is also a businesswoman. So she
absolutely.
And that's great. And she's going to have a perspective that is relative to the fact that she is a businesswoman regarding cosplay. So that's something to keep in mind as well about her.
Yeah, definitely. She has very much a business mindset. And for her, this is her career. This is her job. So she has a lot staked on all of this and keeping things going the way that they are. So it makes sense. I don't blame her.
Yeah, so maybe we're entering a silver age instead. we're getting there. You know, we're still experimenting, we're still learning, figuring out who we are. I don't think we've even approached a golden age yet. Simply because, you know, what we had in the last 10 years was an explosion. I wouldn't say it's a golden age because it wasn't to where we're actually starting to be a productive member of society and start to contribute to our industry.
And we haven't really gotten there yet. We won't be able to do that until we stop putting our fellows down.
Yeah.
We won't be able to enter into a golden age until we start supporting those around us.
Another segue. Speaking of being tolerant and community-oriented, the other thing that we wanted to talk about is a new mini documentary from PBS, and it's from their Off Books line. It's entirely on YouTube. They actually release new episodes every Thursday. And it's about 5 minutes long. So I know people are like, documentary, 5 minutes?
That's what I said.
Yeah. So, no, wait, it is a miniature look at cosplay through a more psychological and academic lens. More of, you know, what place does cosplay occupy in our society at large? What does cosplay do for us as human beings? Like, how does it change us? How does it make us, you know, who we are? And so, if you want to say anything about it first, I watched it last night.
I have not. I'm sorry.
It's 5 minutes. It's actually really easy to digest. I kind of look at it as like another extension of where cosplay boom is going and trying to involve a little bit of every different type of cosplayer into the community. So it's not just those who are quote-unquote cos famous. It's a little bit of everything. So it's kind of cool to see this nice little chunk of, you know, what is cosplay? And let's look at it from a more academic perspective. And that's how you know we're starting to get somewhere, is when the scholastic people start coming up to us and asking really deep philosophical questions. And you're like, okay, we're starting to grow as a community. It's kind of scary and cool at the same time.
We're now psychology experiments.
Yeah, pretty much. Those creepy kids over there wearing the Sailor Moon outfit and the bright orange hair. Yeah, let's talk to them about some philosophy. See what happens.
I do like the fact that they're now talking to cosplayers, not to get eyes on the news, because I know sometimes, you know, the news outlets will go to conventions and they'll find the freakiest looking person just to get views.
Yes.
As someone who
right.
has actually helped to run a convention, I have had run-ins with the media trying to do this. So
it happens way more often than we really want to admit to.
Yes, yes.
Well, and then it also provides negative press. People who don't want to understand or don't try to understand will see this really freaky-looking person who may be completely fine, but they look really strange. And yeah. Well, that's just wrong.
That's
you know?
Why, as a convention, we have to be very careful who we allow in as media.
Oh, yeah.
But the mini documentary kind of started off basically... I had the wrong impression at first, because they were like, you know, costume play is just like Halloween. And I'm sitting there going, wait. You're going to reduce this to hell? Really? Really? No. Because everybody does this. It's like, cosplay is just like Halloween, but not on Halloween. No.
No.
That is different. Costuming. Cosplay is more than Halloween. But thankfully, it didn't continue down that path. It just kind of, it started out that way, and I was
it's
like,
it's an easy way to explain the basic concept of cosplay to someone who has
exactly.
no idea what it is. So, you know.
Exactly. And I think the way that they presented it, because it was from an academic mindset, was a little bit more tongue-in-cheek. Once you get into the body of the video, you're like, okay, that makes more sense now. But still, yeah. Because our biggest problem on Halloween is what to wear. We never know.
Yeah. The 1 year I decided to wear a short skirt instead of a full three-piece suit, I froze my butt off.
Same.
This year.
And they did have, you know, credentialed academics on the documentary talking about the various facets of cosplay. And they covered things like what they called ungender in the community, which is that people can cosplay and not be estranged for it. You know, people aren't going to sit there and rip you to pieces for cosplaying the other gender anymore, which in general society has not been well accepted in general. Cross-dressing is not looked upon favorably in society in general. And they also spoke a lot about tolerance, how just completely tolerant the community is, even though it basically ends up feeling very much like its own community, what they called the, you know, my people. You know, here, let me sing you the song of my people.
You know,
we are a peoples. So they did speak a lot about that, you know, we are isolated, but we always allow other people to come in.
Mm-hmm. And though, I mean, like I said, I didn't watch the documentary, but there are a lot of people within the community who are not tolerant, but we don't like to talk about those people.
It's funny how it's always that small minority of people who are the loudest that make the most racket. And
no matter what group you're in.
It's with every group out there. You can't win. You can't win.
Because they're the ones who get the attention. The
exactly.
The big nasty reactions are the ones that get all the attention because they are so big and nasty, you know.
Exactly. The rest of us who are actually pretty cool, down to earth, who are all about the love and accept, do quote unquote normal. So even in our weird orange hairstyles, but you know.
Mm-hmm.
Like that everywhere, every community. Can't win.
They did touch on cosplay as something that affects us psychologically as people. You know, the putting on and taking off of masks, of personalities, of how it allows you to express different facets that you may not have known that were there. You know, it was a very, very philosophical take on what cosplay is and what it does for us. So for only 5 minutes, I actually found it really good. I kind of wanted to see more. So it was like, okay, this is like a 5-minute preview of what I hope will be an hour-long documentary in the future.
Or a miniseries.
Yes.
Or something, yeah. And since PBS has released a couple of different videos about cosplay, particularly at the Atlanta headquarters, I wouldn't be surprised if there were more coming along the way.
Yes.
They were definitely all over the place at Dragon Con. I never spoke to them, but their cameras were everywhere. Holy crap. Kind of scary.
So if you guys want to find the mini documentary, if you search for PBS Off Books on YouTube, like I said, they release episodes every Thursday night. Basically, they're little cultural kitsch kind of documentaries. They're little 5-minute long looks at various cultural things. So if you want to find it, it's one of their more recent episodes.
Or you can go to our YouTube page and look down our favorites section, because it's right there listed in our favorites. Can't miss it.
That too.
Get people to our YouTubes.
Yes, I mean, we are really grateful for our listeners. I mean, we're about to close out 3 years as a podcast. We're old in terms of podcasts now, since a lot of podcasts don't last 3 years. So we're really glad that you guys are still sticking with us. We're still going to be doing this for a while.
I'm dancing because I didn't think we'd last this long.
I know.
You have little faith.
We are growing, and so we would like to say welcome to our new listeners in China. I saw that we have appeared on their search engines now. So, you know, kudos on you guys. Thank you very much for allowing us to join you guys in your living rooms and on your computers. And I did notice that we have also had a large jump in other international listeners. I noticed we had a boost from listeners in Japan.
Hey.
And we also had boosts from the Netherlands and Sweden. So thank you guys very much. If you guys do enjoy the show, you know, in lieu of donations, since we don't, you know, regularly ask for donations, always welcome, but we don't usually ask for them. We do ask that you share the show. You know, share the link to our homepage, share the link to our feed. Feel free to send episodes to friends, you know, send them the link to our YouTube page. Just spread the word, as that helps us, you know, gain clout with our podcast so that we can do things like bring you awesome interviews. In fact, we're trying to get an interview with Pikmin Link by the end of the year as a treat to you guys.
Fingers crossed. Given our history, I think we should be okay, but it may just be a scheduling thing.
And next year, we're going to try and get Reika on the show as well.
Oh, gosh.
So, you know, the more that you guys can help share the show and, you know, help us with our mission of spreading cosplay and making it more welcoming to people, the more we can do as a show and bring it to you guys. I mean, this is always going to be free, so all we're asking in return is that you guys give us just a little bit of your time. That's all.
That's all.
Yes. Yes, hey, we will buy the equipment, we will take ourselves to conventions, we will take care of all the other stuff.
There you go. And since you're mentioning people potentially helping us, we recently started looking for correspondents. She gives me a thumbs up. Thank you. Segue. We're looking for correspondents throughout the United States to kind of help branch out and give us different perspectives. Since Amber and I are based here in Texas and we do a lot of Southern conventions, even though I do try to travel around every now and then, our perspective is pretty much kind of localized here, and we really would like to get more of a general idea of what's going on around the other around the rest of the country. Right now we're focused on the United States because that's where most of our content comes from, but we are taking things internationally too if we can. We've had a couple of reviews from, what was that, Denmark? Germany? Tell me, I'm going to be wrong, oh, so wrong. What was the last one we got, Amber?
I remember it was NERCON.
NERCON. Okay, see, so many go off saying here that I do not know. My brain do not work. But yeah, if we can, so anyway, we're in this process of looking for more correspondents in the United States. We're looking for Northern and West Coast correspondent. We already have somebody lined up for the East Coast, which is awesome. So if you would like to become one of our correspondents, and we're giving away Epic Cosplay gift cards if you're selected, so that's even more of a cool reason. You get like one or two free wigs from us. Woo! Head to our Facebook page, and you'll find all the details there about how to sign up and all that goodness. So anyway, you guys want to contribute, we are more than happy, because this isn't just our COD podcast, our COD pass? This isn't just our podcast. This is the podcast for everybody, and we love it when you guys help contribute to it.
Mm-hmm. And we do link to, you know, contributors' pages.
Absolutely.
So if you guys send us a con report, we will link to your page as well. And there does tend to be a very large boost in views when that happens. So, you know, we're always happy to help contribute to you as well in return for helping us out with a little bit of content.
Of course, of course.
Mm-hmm. And
I was very diligent about that.
Yes. And we will have those details up on our webpage. I don't know for sure if it will be this weekend, but definitely by next weekend it will be up on our website to where you guys can see it.
Mm-hmm.
And also I hope to add details for conventions who would like to have us as guests. We're also going to list that information as well. Because, you know, for this being a golden age of teaching, we're pretty good panelists at this point. We are very experienced at teaching. We're very efficient. We are organized. You know, we bring a lot of passion for our hobby with us. We've done cosplay contests ourselves. We're both award winners. We're happy to help out with your con. And we offer free media and marketing. So,
marketing.
You know, we would like to give back to our local conventions, you know, in the form of being able to do those things, and being guests help facilitate that. So, of course, if your local con is interested, just have them contact us, and we're happy to talk with them.
It helps that Amber is technically a teacher, and I have technically a PhD, so we're all kind of like teachers already in the real world. Just throwing that out there.
I am not technically a teacher. I do hold, well, I hold a degree in instrumental music, but I did hold a public teacher certificate at one point. So, yes. I just want to clear the record.
We'll not talk about my teaching, okay?
You're yes. Fun to listen to, though. You give a lot of great information. You're entertaining.
It's because I have to entertain two-year-olds. Not you guys, my job.
So that said, let's go ahead and close out this episode 77 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. Of course, we do encourage you to share your thoughts on this episode and the topics we spoke about on all of our social media, which will be listed here. We invite you to subscribe to our feed so that you can get regular updates on when episodes are available. You can also find us on YouTube if you don't want to wait for the feed. And, of course, if you have any ideas for future shows or guests that we should interview, we always welcome those as well. If you guys would like to write to us, our address is podcast@cospod.org. You will usually get two responses, one from each of us. But otherwise, I hope we will see you guys all in episode 78. We hope that our local listeners have a very happy Thanksgiving. Bye, everybody.
Enjoy the dead turkeys.
Ha ha ha!